right. So listening at or reading this story, Kenya's $368 million weekly date headache. Listen, what is even that? Like weekly date headache. And we're talking about $368 million. I tell you what, sometimes I look at all these projects that we have in the different countries in the region, and whereas someone will tell me, yes, these are projects aimed at improving the lives of people, the livelihoods of the people, you could say, or the citizens, or creating employment for them, it is questionable on just how much more we can spend in terms of what we need to borrow to satisfy the different needs that we have as countries or as economies. $368 million weekly date, that is what Kenya is struggling with now. Of course, what's interesting is that our technocrats won't tell you how much ours is weekly, but you know what? I saw a story recently where they're saying about 1,500 billionaires are in this country. The question is, who are they and where is all that money? My name is Simon. Welcome to the Business Show. Here's what's coming up on the show tonight.
We are having discussions or negotiations right from the World Trade Organization, the WTO. We're rolling it to the now the African Continental Free Trade Area for businesses and how their cross-border trade and all. So the policies are actually in place. The negotiations at the AfCFTA level are still ongoing. Some protocols are not yet done, but at least there's hope.
Hello there, and thank you so much for joining us on the program this week. From wherever you're watching, we're glad you could make time. Let's get started with views from the top this week. And the conversation goes down to prior consultation from the citizens before any project, I'm talking about investment projects, can take place in any given society. In the past, we have seen citizens come through, say they have not been compensated, but projects have started. On the other hand, we've seen projects that have started and citizens have fought back, claiming they were either harshly handled or moved off their land without their consent. This week on Views from the Top, I speak to Judith from Siatin, Uganda, who tells us what they are doing about the African Continental Free Trade Area generally, plus the whole prior consulting principle that should ensure that citizens are aware and are okay with the different projects that are supposed to take place in their areas. Of course, this does not only bring development, but also ensures that there is coexistence and, you know, a free business between the host communities and the investors. The big question, however, is doesn't this in any case slow any chances of investment? That and much more in Views from the Top this week.
Thank you, Simon, for having me. My name is Judith Mubara, and I work with Siatin Uganda under the Trade and Investment Program.
Right, let's start with what I would call the really basic or general question. From where you sit, how do you say the different policies are working for businesses generally?
The different policies?
Yes.
Well, there are several policies in place right now. Mm. At the national level, at the regional level, some at the continental or the global level. Mm. How they work is still questionable on the implementation part, but the policies are really in place for businesses. We are having discussions or negotiations right from the World Trade Organization, the WTO. We're rolling it to the now the African Continental Free Trade Area for businesses and how their cross-border trade and all. So the policies are actually in place. The negotiations at the AfCFTA level are still ongoing. Some protocols are not yet done, but at least there's hope. However, the how we're going to approach it, the readiness of our traders, the readiness of our business people to to make good use, to leverage on the opportunities that are availed by FCFTA, that are availed by the WTO policies. Yeah, I think that trickles down to now our government to build capacity of our business people, also to create awareness, to know about these policies just so they can make good use of them.
Okay, so I think about the towards the end of last year, there's a lot of excitement about the African, you know, continental free trade area. And then all of a sudden, it has now gone mute. What's happening?
No, it's actually not mute. It's the protocols were having, the negotiations were still ongoing last year for the phase two. Yeah, the protocols in phase two, that is the competition policy, the investment protocol, and the IP, the intellectual property. So the negotiations were still ongoing. Right now what is happening is they're giving countries or regions to have the implementation strategy in place. Now Uganda launched the implementation, the AFCFTA implementation strategy in December last year. Next week we will be going to the East African community to negotiate and put in place the implementation strategy of the ESC at the regional level. So right now they're giving us, I think, some time to put up together the implementation strategies.
Okay.
But the negotiations are still ongoing, and we are still creating awareness with our business community, with our investors in at the national level, at the regional level, to make good use of the opportunities at the AFCFTA.
Right. We hope the negotiations turn out positive, and the whole idea of whether our traders understand the opportunities or not is the other thing that would probably need to be addressed.
Yeah. Well, I think that we've tried to talk to the government, the line ministries. They're trying to create awareness really with the business communities around.
Okay.
The other day on Monday, we're having a discussion with the youth, because of the youth protocol that is ongoing also at the AFCFTA, to make them to be in the know, to be aware that, look, the opportunity is on, how are we prepared to approach it? So, yeah, we're still creating awareness as a country.
All right, one of the other issues that stands out for what you'd call investment is, if there is a project supposed to come up, let's say in an area, and there are people that, let's say, own the land, there's a whole conversation of, you cannot move people until they have consented to the terms and conditions, or they should be compensated.
Yeah.
So let's talk about the free, prior and informed consent. First of all, what does that mean and how does it actually work?
Okay, the free, prior and informed consent, the FPIC principle, is a right that allows indigenous people have a say or consent to the projects, to the investments that are ongoing, that are going to affect that community. So let's say the community of Nsambia, there's an investment that is going to have maybe a road construction and all. This right, this principle of free, prior and informed consent allows the community people to consent, to sit, to negotiate the conditions with these investors and government so that they can have a benefit sharing on that investment. So it allows these people to have consent, but also withdraw or withhold consent. If they're like, this project is going to affect, let's say, our community, or it's going to affect our environment, then they withhold the consent. So it allows these people to have a say in the investment that is ongoing. And I think this also goes back to the whole, it's passed one to the rights and the principle of economic, social and cultural rights. You give these people, those rights are already availed in, I think, in chapter 4 of the Constitution. So this right is emphasizes that these people now have to be consulted, have to been to participate in the negotiations part before, prior of the investment, before it happens. Let them have a say, let them be aware how this is going to benefit them, how it's going to impact them, how it's going to affect them. If there's anything that is in bad faith, then that will be discussed in the negotiations. And this allows these people to choose who are the negotiators of the community are. Like the district heads, the community leaders, the chiefs, those people come together. They decide for the community. So it's like a roundtable dialogue of investors, government representatives, community leaders, but also community people. And also it also have to be like in their local language, just so they can understand the principles and objectives of the project.
All right, so from where you sit as Yateni, do you think this is fairly being done in Uganda? Or what needs to be addressed?
Okay. From the a few interactions we've had with the communities, personally I've had a benefit of interacting with some communities in Bale, in Mubende, about this free, prior and informed consent on the investments that were ongoing. And what we have, like a take home, what we understood is that very many people don't know about this right. Very many, including the community leaders at the district level. So I think they don't know about their right. They don't know they're supposed to come together with these investors and negotiate these issues. But also, these investments and investors that that go to invest do not involve them. Usually they involve the top guys, so they do not involve the community, the indigenous people on the land. So that's what we gather from some, which is why we are trying to advocate for it, maybe to be appreciated by the community members, to know their rights. Like, hey, you have a right to say no to this thing if it's affecting you. But also it might not be affecting you, but can we have like a benefit sharing? Can you, yes, you're putting this investment, how is the community going to benefit from it? Are you going to like build a hospital so they can access medication? Are you going to build a school? How is it going to affect the environment? So like, it helps them negotiate and know the do's and don'ts of the project.
So paint for us a picture then in regards to, should we choose development over let's wait for people to decide whether this works for them? Yes, don't you think as a country then, a developing country, we'll be wasting so much time on hoping everyone comes to the round table to then agree that I think this won't negatively impact society, so I think the project can go on. Oh, we just have to go on.
So what is going to happen if a government proceeds with this project without a consent from communities is, I think you've seen how communities respond to investments. They will cut down the I saw a picture recently when the people were banging solar panels. A whole investment of how many dollars and dollars, they just come and they decide to put it off. So if you do not engage them, if they are not aware, they might first of all take you to court because it's their rights, but also the reputation damage as an investment. How are you going to you risk reputational damage because they're going to put you up as if you're not relating with the community, which is the end. So the social aspect, the social responsibility aspect has to be considered. If you do not engage them, the risk is too much. You may risk your investment. You may put up your investment and in a way they come and buy it all. And the community, the whole community decides. So it's still you're the one covering the losses. So it's upon you really to engage that.
I strongly believe it's a great policy and a principle, rather, you would call it. And it's important that the people, the host communities, are always consulted on these things. Look, I do not care you telling me a project is going to help the people, or the investor is going to create jobs at the cost of people's lives. Of course, there's always going to be a thin line between at what point should the government wait for the people to decide that, yes, now we can take over the land and invest, or should we move the people by force? That is something that It's good to know that government is engaging the people, and we can only hope that in the near future, all this back and forth of compensation can be done so business can flow smoothly and the locals should also, you know, equally benefit from this project. Yeah. While you're watching The Business Show with me, Simon, time now on the quick break on the program. When I get back, I'll be telling you more about what you need to do to start small as a business person or that person planning to start a business. Also, we'll be giving you the tips on how to handle your personal finances. In the meantime, feel free to get in touch with us on our socials right below your screen and tell us what you think. We'll see you shortly.